Good afternoon, everyone. I am Amikraj Behra, a BSc first year undergraduate student at Chennai Mathematical Institute. Today is the second week of STEMS lecture series, and today's second talk will be given by Professor Sharad Sane on the talk titled Mathematical Games. Professor Sharad Sane did his MSc from IIT Bombay in 1974 and completed his PhD from IIT Bombay in 1979. He is also the author of the book named Combinatorial Techniques and co-author of the book Quasi-Symmetric Designs. So I invite Professor Sharad Sane.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Yeah, I guess you can all can move ahead, that will be better. You see, it's not from the point of view of listening to me, but I would like to write something on the board. And that case, if you are sitting in the front rows, that is better, that we can see. Okay. All right, what is one's understanding of games, mathematical games, or any game for that matter? So let's be clear about the protocol that we have. Namely, there are two players playing the game, A and B, let's call them A and B. They take turns. A plays first, then B, then A. Like in game of chess, for example. Chess is a kind of game. There are other kinds of games. For example, there are games played by card games that are played with several people. Okay, they're more complicated than the kinds of games that I'm talking about. Many, many, many card games are played with larger than two players. And of course, there's a winning criteria. Someone is declared a winner, and the other person is a loser, etc. We have to simplify these models, go on simplifying them as we go on. So we don't want to have draws, for example, right at the beginning. So we make the rules in such a manner that there are no draws. Okay. Many games do result in draws. For example, game of chess, a large number of chess games, actually, if the players are good, and that is what happens many times, they result in a draw. Whereas the kind of situation we're talking about, one player is to be declared winner, and there's a clear criteria to decide that. Okay. More or less, also the rules of the game are decided right at the beginning. We decide the rule. You cannot change the rules of the game in the middle of the game. Is that clear? You can't swap the thing around and say that, no, I want to change the rule and opposite of that should be true, etc. I mean, that just cannot be allowed. I'm sure many of you, you like mathematics and are good students. So you would have played this kind of subtraction or maybe addition game. Like I announce a number which is between, say, 1 to 10. Okay? So that creates, so it's like my putting so many chips on the table. So I put 7 chips on the table. Then my opponent puts a certain number of chips on the table. So if I put 7 chips and he puts 2 chips, then the kitty becomes 9 chips on the table. So the table keeps increasing. And what is the rule now? Every player is allowed to has to put a certain number of chips, 1 to 10 chips on the table. The first player who will make the total 100 is the winner. Have you played this game? You have? So how does one play this? first player has advantage. In general, in all these games, you should expect that the first player has an advantage. Which way? Okay, sure. You want to play this game with me? Yeah? To begin with, I mean, shall we? Who wants to go first? You want to go first? You go first. So how many chips do you want to put on the table? Huh? Nine chips? Okay. Maybe I put eight chips on the table. What is the total now? 17, yeah, 17 chips on the table. What do you do then? You put one, makes a total of 18, so someone should keep a track of this, yeah? The 18 chips on the table now. So I put seven chips, what is the total? 25. How many chips do you put? Two? 27, so you seem to like the number two. Okay, so the... You put two chips on the table, that makes a total 27. I now put seven chips on the table. What is the total? Huh? 34. What do you want to do? Two? Okay, it's the total of 36 chips on the table now. Okay, that's fine. I put nine chips on the table. I add nine chips to the table. What's the total? 45 chips, yes, you go ahead. Nine more, so was the total 54, yeah? Okay, I add two chips now to the table. That makes a total of 56, yeah? Seven more, 63. Oh, see, then I put four chips on the table. That makes a total of 67. Sorry? Five, so 68, is that okay? Then I, 68? Huh? So the total has become 72? Okay. Then I put six chips on the table, making a total 78. 78 is the current total. Three, 81. Then I put eight chips on the table, making a total 89. And now it's kind of clear that there is a design. There is a design. This is the whole idea in basically the mathematical games. This is the idea that there is a clearly thought out plan. The moment I get to 89, you kind of shrug shoulders and would want to give it up, etc. Because no matter how clever you are, you can put only number of chips from 1 to 10. Okay, you cannot hit 100. And whatever number you say, I can adjust accordingly, making certain that I can get to 100. Is that clear? Some sense what should be called, 100 is of course a winning number. 100 is the winning number. But there is a kind of number that is before 100. And something that I knew, that is 89. The moment I make certain that there are 89 chips on the table and place the table before you, no matter how clever you are, okay, I'm assured of win. Yeah. And if 89 happens to be a good number, you go back now. If 89 is a good number, which it is, then there should be a good number before that. And what is that good number? 78, etc. Now you go on. So this kind of analysis is what is called backtracking. It is a backtracking idea. So you declare some set of numbers, vertices. In general, this is done. There is a graph that you can draw. What is this game? For this game, what is the graph about? Numbers from 0 up to 100. You draw an edge from I to J. there is an edge that goes from I to J. If you can go, actually, if there are I chips on the table, and you can make them to J chips, so J has to be bigger than I. So J has to be a number which is from I plus 1 up to I plus 10, OK? Every such thing is an edge. In this graph, I go on moving in a certain direction. Beginning with 0, you go on moving till you get to 100. The first person who gets 100 is the winner. Therefore, 100 is a good vertex. 100 is a good node. That vertex could to be called 100 because the game stops there. Game just stops there. For 100 to be a good number, 89 is a good number for this game. For this game, 89 is a good number. Then, therefore, 78 is a good number. So on and so forth. Is this clear? Is it clear? Yeah. So these bunch of numbers, this set of numbers, that's called the kernel. So kernel is a, so this is a big graph that we have. You all understand what graph is? Yeah. Graph is something where you have a collection of nodes, finite number of nodes, and you can move from one node to other node. What level are you? Are you all from school or college? College, okay, so you understand that. So kernel is a collection of good numbers, good vertices, okay? Therefore, this brings to the whole thing of being, one should be able to define what kinds of games we're admitting. So the kinds of games we're admitting, those are the ones where the winning positions are clearly spelled out. In this game, the winning position was 100. Reaching 100, as soon as somebody gets to 100, the game stops there. You don't play any further. Rules are also clearly specified. You know from which vertex you can go to which vertex, etc. There is no going back. For example, this game does not allow you you can add certain number of chips on the table, okay? It's not the case that someone can also subtract number of chips from the table, okay? That's not allowed in this game. If that is allowed, you may be able to go on playing this forever. Yeah? Is that clear? I mean, two people can make it as boring as possible. Yeah? You put certain number of chips and the other fellow removes those many chips and this cannot be done, okay? So such a thing is called it's a progressively finite game. You just progressively just means you can go only in one direction. You cannot get back. Also, you have to add certain number of chips on the table. You can't just say that I add 0 chips to the table. That amounts to giving a bid like in the game you want to pass. You just say pass. There are games where you are allowed to say pass. You know that? Have you? There's a famous game that allows you to say pass. If you, some of you or your dads have played this game called bridge, okay? In the game of bridge, you are allowed to say pass in the bidding round that they have. You are allowed to say pass. In fact, it does so happen in the game of bridge that all the four people say pass. Okay? This is perfectly valid situation. In the game of bridge. That's not allowed here. You can't say pass. I mean, this is also true in many other games, such as in chess, you cannot say pass. Okay? You're not allowed to say pass. I mean, that's not allowed. I don't want to move. That's not allowed. Okay? It's just not allowed. So pass is a disallowed thing. But chess is not quite progressively finite. Why is that? That's because you can repeat a position. You can come back. You can come back to the same position. For example, you can take the knight out to a certain square and bring it back to the same position. This will exactly repeat the position. And that's not allowed here. Just not allowed. Even game of chess, in principle, can probably be played forever. It's possible that two people can make an agreement and just go on playing it. That's not allowed here. It's not allowed. So these are much simpler. The kinds of games we're talking about, they're much simpler. It's just that for every such game, that thing that I'm calling kernel, it will have to be found out separately. For example, if I change the rules of the game to, instead of adding numbers up to 10, you can only add numbers up to 7, then that kernel will change. Is it clear? Instead of 10, you have to, now everything is with, so therefore 92 will become a good number, etc., etc. Then you can backtrack. You can buy. Also, you can make it for, these games can be made more difficult. For example, I can allow you to add any number from 1 to 10, but not number 5. Okay. You are allowed to, so you should add any number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, but not 5. 5 is not allowed. And you can forbid. And that's also progressively finite, but it will have a different kernel. The kernel for that game will be different. In contrast, there are certain games where parity, symmetry of situation is exploited. Okay, these are relatively easier games. These are comparatively easy. So let me dispose of some of them. Let me dispose of some of them. Take the standard 8x8 chessboard. Okay. What I want to do is, you know how a king moves in the game of chess. Now, so king can, a centrally placed king can move to any one of the 8 adjacent squares. Assume that this cannot move. You can only move from sideways, or you can move up, down. Okay. So you can move north, south, east, west. Okay. There are only 4 possibilities. Okay. Is it clear? What you have to do is, I will capture a certain square. You have to capture a square which is adjacent to that square. How is adjacency defined? Just by what I said. And if you play chess, if I'm talking of a square like A4, for example, what are the squares adjacent to that? That is A5 or A3, and then B4, or that is all, okay, because you are at the end, okay. Whereas if you are something like, if you are on C4, then it is C5 or C3, and D4 and B4, okay? The ones on the 4 sides of that square. And so A captures a certain square, B captures a square which is adjacent to that. The person who cannot move at all till the time the entire board gets exhausted. And the person who finishes, if a person cannot move, so the rule here is, if a person cannot move, cannot capture anything further, then he loses. Otherwise, a person who makes the last move, he is the winner. How should this be played and who has the advantage? This is based on a very simple idea. So that tiling, yeah, go ahead, yeah. So what you do is you just tile the thing. If there are 8x8 chessboard, you can tile it using 32 dominoes. You can put dominoes. You can cover this entire thing by dominoes. Domino puts hand on, each domino covers a white cell and a black cell, exactly one, okay? Exactly one white and one black. And now the rule is, it's very clear. So the correct strategy for B is to keep moving on the domino every time. Is it clear? See, if A puts, A captures a certain square, then B captures a square which is on the domino that is placed on that particular square, okay? By doing this, you make certain that this is, it's very clear that we will always have a move. We will always have a move. So at the end of the run, when 32 times this has been played, the 64th square that will be captured, that will be done by B. That's clear. So this is just based on a parity kind of argument, symmetry, some kind of symmetry that one is trying to exploit here. There are other games where the same idea is exploited. So let me see, a parity-based game could be something like this. There is an odd number of chips on the table. Now this is, what should we say? This is subtraction. What is happening here is you are subtracting things. So there's something like 9 chips on the table. A removes certain number of chips from the table, then B removes, then A removes, etc. The person who removes the last chip is the winner. The rule being, every time you can remove only one chip or two chips, not more than that, and you have to move on. For example, if there are 9 chips on the table and A is the first player to move, if they keep removing one chip at a time, A would be winner, that's clear, because it's an odd number. Is it clear? Because it's an odd number. But B doesn't have to follow that, okay? B could have removed 2 chips. Nothing prevents B from removing 2 chips. This is what is called the, yeah, it's a good name, suggestive name. Oddball. In case of oddball, the person who, at the end of the thing, someone will have odd number of chips and someone will have even, the other person is guaranteed to have even number of chips because the total is odd, okay? The person who gets odd number of balls, odd number of chips, he is the winner. How should this be played? For example, if there are 3 chips on the table, and if I'm playing the oddball game, and if I have to begin the game, what is it that I should be doing? Just take one chip, that's clear. Yeah? Is that okay? No. Because then B can also take one chip from the table, okay? Therefore taking, but on the other hand, if I take 2 chips, then I have lost already. Is that clear? Therefore, if the total number of chips is 3, then B will win this game. Okay? No matter what A plays, we will win this game. Okay? What about 5 chips on the table? A will win. How? A will take 2 chips. Now it's a transformation because you kind of remember things. Yeah. You remember how the thing was played when there were 3 chips. Okay. So from 5, you went. So there is a kind of inductive logic that is happening here. We know how to do it for 3. So it's a transpose situation where instead of A, B is starting the game. B is starting the game. Now A knows how to play it. Is this clear? So for oddball, with 3, A wins. Is it A wins or B wins? B wins. Of course, I could have changed the game. So there is a game that's called Even Steven. So in case of Even Steven, the person who amasses even number of chips, he is the winner. Now the tables are turned exactly the other way around. If there are three chips, who should win? A will win, that's clear. Because A just takes off two chips, okay? Forcing B to take the remaining chip and A will win. But if there are five chips, yeah, in case of five chips, B will win. How? Yeah. A will win. A will win. Yeah. What does A do to begin with? He takes away one chip. Yeah, that's correct. Taking away two chips is not the right strategy. He takes away one chip. And if B takes two, then he takes one still. Okay. And if B takes only one, then he also takes one. Is that okay? No? No. So who is the winner? Look, if A takes two chips, then B will take two chips, and therefore A will lose. That's very clear. Okay? So A must choose to take only one chip. Now, if B takes two, then A takes one, and therefore A is ensured a win. But if B takes one, A takes one, B takes one, A again takes one. Okay. Therefore, B wins. Therefore, in all situations, B wins. So there is a parity-based argument here. It's very clearly what is meant by parity. This is an odd number. There are two types of odd numbers. Odd numbers get split into two types. They're partitioned into two types. Some that are like three and some that are like five. And those are called three modulo four. Others are called five modulo or one modulo four. One modulo four. And for each one of them, there should be a winner that can be decided. I have the thing written up here. So let me. So for anything of the form 3 mod 4, is this all right? Is it okay to call? Once this is clear, You can give me any number of chips. You can give me 13 chips on the table. You can give me 27 chips on the table. That's okay. No problems. I can handle that situation. I know. Only thing is, each time one has to do this calculation. And this is pretty messy. See, number of choices, you take away one chip, then what will he do, depending on that, what answer one should give, etc. It's not very clear. And what do mathematicians do when you cannot solve a certain problem directly? You try to generalize it. So there is a clear generalization of this. What kind of generalization is this? And now, instead of all these games worked on the basic thing that they have odd number of balls. Number of balls is odd, and therefore, at the end of the day, someone comes out with odd number of balls in his pocket, the other person will have even number of balls. Therefore, depending on whether it's odd ball or even Steven, the winner is accordingly decided. Okay, if it's even number of balls, it's the winner is the one who gets even number of balls, so on and so forth. Okay. You could generalize this to any number of balls on the table. Now there is a problem. Okay. For example, if I have 10 chips on the table, and if I'm playing odd ball, then it is possible that both of them, at the end of the thing, both of them get odd number of balls. It is possible. One gets 5 balls, the other person also gets 5 balls. Who should be declared a winner? Well, so we have to decide the rule for this game. For this, I decide that A is the winner. In case of odd ball, A is the winner if A gets odd number of balls. Okay. And what is it that B should be doing? B prevents A from doing this. B has to prevent A from getting odd number of balls. So if the total number of balls is 10, and if A should not get odd number of balls, then B should see to it that he gets even number of balls. Well, that makes certain that A also gets even number of balls. Is that clear? So B's work is limited to preventing A from getting odd number of balls. And same thing is true with even Steven. Okay? If you're playing even Steven with something like 28 balls, A wins if A gets even number of balls. By doing that, B will also get even number of balls, because even plus even is even. Okay? What is it that B should be doing? B has to prevent A from doing that. Which means B should see to it that A gets odd number of balls. Therefore, B himself should get odd number of balls. If we can decide winner in all these cases, then to solve this problem of odd balls and even Steven, one can make a theorem which will cover all possible cases. Because then one can run an inductive argument. You can then get into induction, a straightforward induction. Induction will work. Is it clear that if there are 7 chips on the table and I take out one chip, then it's a situation, if I'm talking of odd ball, then out of 7 I want to get odd number of balls. So in the pool of 6, I should be getting even number of balls. But instead of I starting the game, my opponent B is starting the game. So it's a game in which it is even Steven with B starting, and A wants to win. Therefore, it should be the second person who should be winning, so on and so forth. Is that clear? What I'll do is, I'll just write down the winners. And you should go home and verify them. Yeah, so it's relatively easy. If someone gives these things, then it should be easy to check that. Is it clear? You should be able to do that by induction. It's a straightforward induction then. Yeah. So let's see. So n is the total number of balls. Let's check this. When suppose k is zero actually. So if there are no, if there are no balls at all, who is the winner? In case of even Steven, it is A. That's clear. Because in case of odd ball, it's B. If there is only one ball on the table, in case of even Steven, it is B. In case of odd ball, it is A. In case there are two balls on the table, in case of even Steven, A just takes away both the balls and A is the winner. In case of odd ball, A takes away one ball. B also gets one ball, but then A is winner. That's clear. In case there are three chips on the table, and it's even Steven, therefore A takes away two balls, and then A is winner. In case it is odd ball, if A takes two, then B takes one, and therefore B wins. If A takes one, then B also takes one. Forcing A to take the third ball, and therefore A will amass even number of balls, and therefore B will win. Therefore, this is verified for n equal to 0, 1, 2, 3. This table is correct table for 0, 1, 2, 3. Now, based on this, I should be able to work for any n, because the table is given to me. I should exactly know how to follow the strategy. Placing myself in position of B, A or B, depending on what is given on the table. Okay? Yeah. So what I was getting at here, in case of this, is being able to find kernel for the game. There was a big theorem proved about 100 years ago, almost 100 years ago. Someone proved a theorem that said that every progressively finite game has a kernel. If this is the case, and if I know what the kernel is, then I know how to win the game. Okay? Any progressively finite game has to have a kernel. Therefore, the problem then boils down to, for a given game, how to find a kernel. How to find the kernel for that particular game is all that one has to know. This is easier said than actually achieved. Okay? There is a, in fact, let me motivate. How many of you have heard this game called NIM? NIM game, yeah. There are a number of people. NIM is a classical example of a progressively finite game. NIM is absolutely a classical example of a game that is progressively finite. Okay? So how is NIM game played? Huh? You have some chips on the table, yes. Can you just remove any number of chips on the table? Split it up. It's predetermined. In what way is it predetermined? No, that is a little restricted. Okay. Does someone know any other version? Yeah, you raise your hand. So, sorry, same? Okay. Yeah. stacks. That's correct. There are stacks there. Yeah. Certain number of chips in it. Yeah. And the person who removes the last chip is the winner. Because the every stack will become empty eventually, that's clear. Again, it's a progressively finite game. You cannot say pass. You can't say that I don't want to remove any chip at all. That's not allowed. Yeah, and the, so is it clear what he's saying? So what he's saying is, let me write these stacks like this. So this is the first stack. That's the second stack. That's the third one. So there are four stacks here. The first one has four chips in it. Second one has three. Third has two. Fourth also has two. Okay. What you can do is you cross off, you take off any number of chips, but from the same stack. Same stack is important here. How does one play? And what is the correct strategy for name game? Sorry? No, backtracking will be, in principle, okay. In principle, backtracking is a good idea. When it comes to actually working it out, I cannot, backtracking is an idea. You see, this is an easy situation. What is this? This is like 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 2. Okay, I can change that to 50 plus 42 plus 39 plus 78. Those numbers can be changed and then you're not going to backtrack every time. Yeah, well, that's exactly the use of mathematics. That's exactly where mathematics has a role. Backtracking, yes, but what is it that one? Let's take situation when you have only two stacks. Let's look at it. Say that again. Suppose there is only one stack. Who is the winner? First player, that's very clear. There is only one stack and there are 10 chips in that stack. I just take away all the 10 chips. That's very clear. Okay? So if there is only one stack, there is nothing to prove here. is it clear? So based on this, if there are two stacks, No, that will not work. Yeah. Okay. No, that's okay. I mean, that's kind of, way of thinking this. I mean, let's say the first stack had 10 chips and the second stack had 15 chips. You want to play this game with me? I mean, okay, we can do that. First stack has 10 chips and second has 15. Should I go first? It's just that if I play it, you'll know how I'm winning. I mean, if there are 10 chips in the first stack and 15 in the second stack, I remove 5 chips from the second stack. Now, how many is each stack left with? 10. There are 10 in every stack. What do? If you remove 3 stacks, 3 chips from the first stack, I remove 3 from the second. I basically mimic your actions in the other stack. If I do that, who will be the winner? It's very clear that the player who does the mimicking, he is the winner. Is it clear? Of course, by following the same strategy, if number of chips into two stacks that are given is same, suppose there are 100 chips in each stack, then you can, and if I'm the first one to go, you can win the game. Is it clear? You can certainly win the game. If I remove four from stack number one, then you remove equally many from stack number two. Is it clear? You just mimic the action. By doing this, you ensure that you will be the last one to remove. You will be the one to remove the last chip. Okay? Only thing is, we have to deal with not two stacks, but we may have to deal with 10 stacks. What do you do? Now, this simple-minded thing will not work with 10 stacks. You cannot, what is it? But roughly, it gives some idea of what needs to be done. This gives some idea for what needs to be done. Yeah, what is... It doesn't really depend on even number of stacks or odd number of stacks. That's, no. I mean, your idea is clear. You want, kind of want to pair them up. Yeah, I mean, that's the, that is behind your mind, yeah? You want to pair them up. But see, this pairing them up may not be the, and the whole picture will be very messy. So this is based on a pretty simple idea. You all know what a binary expansion of an integer is. So binary expansion is writing a number in base 2. Writing a number in base 2 and yeah, 2 cube. Is it okay? Base 2 writing. Number is the usual number system that we follow, the way we write numbers now, the world we live in. We write numbers to base 10. Base 10 is the accepted thing with digits going from 0, 1, 2, 3 up to 9. Instead of that, suppose you live in the binary world, then the digits are only 0 and 1. Therefore, you write everything in terms of powers of 2. And there's nothing special about 10. Therefore, instead of base 10, you have base 2. And there's also unique. There's a unique binary expansion for any number. With this, I define an operation, addition, a special addition operation. Namely, in case of binary also, you can add numbers. For example, if if I have to add these two numbers, what is it that I'll be doing? I add 1 plus 1. Is that okay? 1 plus 1, then write a 0 there. Then there is a carry to the next. You keep carrying the things leftwards. So there is a carry of 1 there. Then 1 plus 1 plus that one. Then 1. Then there is a carry, et cetera, et cetera. So that's exactly the same way. This concept of carry is very important. It's very important. Many times when one is taught these things in school, so there is a student who has asked this problem, and people said his arithmetic is very good. Yeah, I mean, that's clear because he just added. But the same student, what he or she did, Now this is incorrect. Where is the problem? The problem is you forgot the carry. You forgot the... So if the teacher had given this problem instead of the second problem, the teacher would not have been able to make out that the student has not understood carry. I mean, his ignorance is somewhere hidden. That is all that will happen. Teacher will not be able to make out that the student has not really understood addition. Okay? With the first example, you are not sure whether he has understood the concept of carry because there is no carry here. In this case, there is a carry and therefore he's caught. His answer is incorrect because there is a carry. Not all additions involve carry. Some don't and some do. You have to keep a track of that. So imagine as if now in case of binary, we perform addition without a carry. So this is not a normal addition operation. So what is it that I'll be doing if I have to add? Let's call this a new addition. One plus one is zero. One plus one is zero. This is one and this is one. What it means is 11 plus seven. What is this number equal to? That is two cube. That is two square. Okay. So this is a new addition. Let's call this digital addition. It's a new addition. 11 plus 7 is not equal to 12. In the normal arithmetic with which we live, 11 plus 7 is not equal to 12. Advantage here is that, just check this. If this is the case, then B plus C is A. Is it clear? Or, for that matter, very strange thing is bound to happen. A plus A is zero. If you add A to itself, it becomes equal to zero. A number added to itself. Digital sum is zero. So it is the digital sum which is solution to the Fibonacci, to the NIM problem. Namely, what you do is you calculate the digital sum of the number of chips in each, on each stack. Get the digital sum. If the digital sum is zero, those are exactly the positions that are in the kernel. Those where the digital sum is not equal to zero, they are not in the kernel. And what you can say is, from a position which is not in the kernel, I can move to a position that is in the kernel. And from a position which is in the kernel, you are forced to move to a position which is not in the kernel. So the idea of kernel is something like this. This also explains the idea of kernel. Namely, kernel is a bunch of vertices. From anything outside, you can always step in the kernel. From anything outside, you can always get in the kernel. Whereas from anything that is in the kernel, you cannot remain in the kernel. Is it clear? From a kernel position, you can only make moves that are outside the kernel. Whereas from anything that is outside the kernel, you can always choose a good move that will take you into the kernel. Then it's very clear that if I can find a kernel for a game, it gives me a winning strategy. I just keep moving. So how is any progressively finite game to be played? Two steps. I mean, one is you find the kernel for that game. You get in the kernel, whatever move your opponent makes, it will take the thing out of the kernel, no matter how clever he is. He is forced to take the things out of the kernel, then from that, you can get in the kernel. Then he thinks, scratches his head, but still has to move out of the kernel, and then from that you can move in the kernel. But because by definition, the winning vertex is in the kernel, winning things are in the kernel, you are assured of a win. That's very clear. This is the idea of winning a progressively finite game. A prototypical example of this is the NIM. NIM game is a very nice example of this. Try playing this. Try playing this with your friends, brothers, sisters. Okay, do that. It's worth doing it. I gave you the answer. Namely, you have to make digital sum equal to zero. This is the key. In case of two stacks, if those two stacks have identical number of chips, then it's clear that the digital sum is equal to zero. If they don't have identical number of chips, then the digital sum cannot be equal to zero. It cannot be. If A is not equal to B, A plus B cannot be equal to zero. There is cancellation here. Though this operation looks weird, it cannot be true that A plus B is equal to zero, but A plus A is also zero, you see. And if that is the case, if I can just cancel off A, then that will mean that B is equal to A, which is the case, okay? So if what's the conclusion? Conclusion is if B is not equal to A, then A plus B cannot be equal to zero. A digital sum B can never be equal to zero, okay? So the key to winning NIM game is every time make a move so that the digital sum is equal to zero. From that, no matter how clever your opponent is, he has to move out of the kernel, namely make the digital sum not equal to zero. And then from that you can get to digital sum equal to zero, etc., etc. The final position being 0000. The winner is decided that way. Is this clear? There's more involved than the simple-minded example of making the sum 100, or those are easy examples. Those are relatively much easier examples. You have any questions? So I have a question for you. So someone modified the NIM game. So let me make a modified NIM game, namely, there is a certain number of stacks. So there is a bottom stack here. Then there is a stack. From any stack, you can push any number of chips from this stack. You can push them. So there are four chips here. Out of those, you choose three of them and then push them to the next level. Okay. And then when from here, I can push all of them out. So every time the chips keep moving, they do keep moving from stack that is at the top, you go to the stack that is below, etc., etc. What is the final position? No stack is left with any chip at all. That is the thing. But if there are 10 chips in stack number 3, I cannot take away all of them. I can't just take away. So this cannot be. You can only take away things from stack number 1. Is it clear? So this is kind of like NIM, but it's not NIM. It's not NIM. And you push the chips to the next stack, etc. From the bottom stack, you can take away any number of chips. Okay? This game will end somewhere. That's very clear because you keep pushing things. This is what is called staircase name. Obviously, why it is called staircase is clear. It's a staircase name. What should be the winning strategy for staircase name? Now, this is little involved than what one may think, but I'll let you think about it. If you don't get an answer, you can write to me, of course. I will provide you with answer, okay? Yeah, for example, let me give you one situation, then you can think about it. Suppose there are two stacks. The bottom stack is empty. And the top stack has something like 10 chips on it. And whatever turn you have, what is it, suppose you are the first player to move. You can move certain, you can push certain number of chips from stack number two to stack number, the bottom stack. If you push four chips from here to the bottom stack, what is it that I will do? I'll take away all of them. Now it's very clear that I can win the game. Is it clear? It's very, no matter how many chips there are in stack number two, that's irrelevant. It's absolutely irrelevant. Even if there are 100 chips, in stack number two, it's very clear because, I mean, it's literally like game playing. You're literally playing game because whatever chips you throw to bottom stack, I just take them off. I just remove them. But this worked with two stacks. I mean, so it's something like the bottom stack has to look a certain way. And if bottom stack has to look that way, then stack number, which is at the bottom, and the one which is at level 3 or level 5, etc., they have to do something. So think about it. Okay? So that's the idea in solving staircase name. It's more involved than the name. Okay, let me see what I... Yeah, this one is quite famous on the parity-based question. So what you have is at every stage, whatever number of chips there are on the table, you have to take a proper divisor of that. Proper divisor of that number. Add those many chips. And who is the winner? Winner is the person who make total. What is the year now? 2019. The question is as follows. There are two chips on the table to start with. I start the game. I take a proper divisor. What is meant by proper divisor? Not equal to n. It could be one. That is possible. Okay. The proper divisors have different definitions at times. So one is okay. But n is not all right. N is not okay. You have to add those many chips to the existing number of chips on the table. The first person who makes a total 2019 or above, he is the winner of the game. For example, if I'm the first person to play this game, it's clear that I can add only one chip, that's clear. So from two, it will go to three. Then what is it that you will be doing? From three, where will it go to? Four. Now when the total is four, I have a choice. I can add either one chip or I can add two chips, okay? Suppose I add two chips, then there are six chips on the table. Then you have a choice. You can add one chip, you can add two chips, or you can also add three chips, etc. This is a purely parity-based argument. Yeah, let me give you answer to this right away. Do that? Yeah. Okay. If you have a number which is odd, then all of its divisors are odd numbers. Okay? This is very clear. If you have a number that is even, then it has both odd and even divisors. So person for whom the number of chips on the table is an even number, he has more choice. He clearly has more choice. So the game is to be played like this. For example, beginning with two, I add one chip to the table, that makes a total of three. My opponent adds one chip to the table, that makes a total of four. Now I add one chip to the table, that makes a total five. The number five is an odd number. And a proper divisor of that number is an odd number, which is not even half of that number, which cannot be half of that number, because this number is an odd number. So proper divisor of that number will be less than or equal to one third of that number, okay? And when he adds an odd number to an odd number, what he gets, the total will have an even number. I can now conveniently choose an odd divisor of that even number so that the total becomes odd. Now he has an odd number of chips on the table, and therefore, what is it that I'll be doing? Break this to a situation, calculate something like two-thirds of this number, whatever is two-thirds of that number, okay? At that point, I can conveniently add half of that and get a total which is about 2019, okay? I keep the button in my hand in the sense that every time I make certain that number of chips for the opponent is an odd number, therefore his choice is restricted. He has a restricted choice. Whereas with me, the number of chips on the table is even, and therefore I can add as many as half of them, which facility he does not have. He does not have that facility. And I can ensure that that facility becomes available to me every time, whereas it's not available to him. Is it clear? Now the same idea is used in other kinds of things. For example, there's a very famous game called the Fibonacci Nim. It's called the Fibonacci Nim. How many of you know the number Fibonacci numbers? This is a pretty large number, that's good. So what are Fibonacci numbers like? What's a Fibonacci number? Or there's a Fibonacci sequence. What's a Fibonacci sequence? Sorry? 0, 1, 1, yeah, good. Then 2, then 5, 8, 13, 13, the previous two. You add the previous two and you get. So the game is like this. You have something like pretty large number of chips on the table, and maybe 900 chips on the table. The players take turns. You can remove number of chips from the table. First A removes a certain number of chips from the table, then B removes, etc. Let's make a slightly easier version of Fibonacci. Let's play this. This should be easy. This should be comparatively easy. So there is a number of chips on the table. I remove a certain number of chips from it. Then you remove a certain number of chips from it, which is not bigger than the number that I removed. Is it clear? You can only remove a number which is less than or equal to the number that I removed. So suppose I remove 10 chips from the table, you can remove 7 chips from the table. And then I can also remove 7 chips, or I can remove less than that, etc. Okay? Winner is the person who gets the last chip. If the number of chips is odd, then it's clear that I can win the game. How do you do that? Take one. Make certain that this is a purely parity-based argument. If there are 9 chips on the table, you keep removing one. Your opponent does not have a choice. He has to remove one only. Okay? And then you will be there. But that's okay. But if there are 10 chips on the table, what do? Because if I keep removing one, then he will win. Yeah. Oh, you can't remove all of them. That's a good question. In fact, I forgot to say that. Okay. I mean, you have to make substance out of that game. You cannot remove the first person to walk away with all of them. Okay. How should this be played? Sorry, half? Five? Then if I take 5, he'll also take 5. This is based on a binary expansion. So it's a plain idea there. 5 is equal to 2 cube plus 2 square. Is that all right? No. 5 is equal to 2 cube plus 2. 5 is equal to 2 cube plus 2 power 1. Okay? So now you remove 2. You remove 2 chips from the table. Okay? If you remove 1, then there is no problem at all. Then it's clear that I can. Because it's like I become the second player. Yeah? If he keeps removing 2, then it's okay. Then this is as good as playing the game at a level where everything is multiplied by 2. The previous situation with things multiplied by 2. So the correct strategy to win this game is to make a binary expansion of the given number. For any number, there is a binary expansion. That binary expansion has the smallest number in it, what we can call the tail of the binary expansion. For 10, for example, what is the tail? Tail is 2 power 1. That is the tail. You can also define length of a binary expansion. For 10, what is the length? Length is 2. Length is 2 because it involves 2 powers of 2. 2 cube and 2 power 1. Okay? Length does not increase with n, not necessarily. It drops down. For example, for 8, the length is only 1. And for 9, it is 2. Okay? Anything which is a power of 2, the length is only 1. And the correct strategy to win this is to remove the tail. Remove the tail every time. Remove the tail of the binary expansion every time. And that ensures a win for the first player. It's just that some binary expansions don't have tails. For example, if something is a power of 2, then there is no tail. And as we said, the stipulation of the game, if there are 8 chips on the table, I cannot take away all the 8. I'm not allowed to do that. Okay? So that's the only hitch. A Fibonacci name is a more involved thing than this. That depends on what is called the Fibonacci expansion of a number. There's a deeper theorem in mathematics. You can write any given number as a sum of Fibonacci numbers. It is possible to write any number as a sum of Fibonacci. Yeah, there is a rejoinder there. Namely, you can't just, it's not exactly like binary expansion. For example, we said that 3 and 5 are Fibonacci numbers. And so is 8, the next number. So you would be able to write 8 in two ways. Namely, 8 is equal to 8, and 8 is 5 plus 3. Now that should not be allowed. You should not be using consecutive Fibonacci numbers. 3 and 5 are consecutive Fibonacci, and those are not allowed. Okay. With that stipulation, it is unique. But this is a little involved theorem. A little involved theorem, what is called the Zeckendorf expansion. How much time do I have? Huh? 6? 10? Okay, then let's go to this positional game. It is worth. You all have played these games like tic-tac-toe. A 3x3 tic-tac-toe. You put cross and circle there. For 3x3, who is the winner? It's generally a draw. Mostly, I mean, both players are playing it already, it's a draw. But instead of 3x3, I can play it on 10x10 or 8x10. Okay. For 8x10, what are the winning? I mean, all the horizontal lines are winning, all the vertical lines are winning, and if there is a diagonal, then the two diagonals are also winning, okay? So tic-tac-toe is a typical example of positional game. So what is called a positional game? What's a positional game like? You have a large enough set. Universal set and some subsets of order n. What do players and we do exactly like tic-tac-toe game? So the here, in case of tic-tac-toe, the elements of this universal set are the squares. They are actually the cells on the tic-tac-toe board. Okay. What are these sets? These sets are either the horizontal lines or the vertical lines or the diagonals. Okay. These are the sets. Each have order n. Each has order n. A player puts a cross or a dot on any element. So players keep capturing elements. They keep capturing elements. A person who can capture all the n elements of a set, he's the winner. And then the game stops there. Is it clear? So this generalizes the tic-tac-toe. The idea of tic-tac-toe is exactly captured here in this positional situation. It's a more general picture than the tic-tac-toe. And what is it that's involved here? I want to know who will win, of course. So there is a remarkable theorem of this, what is called the Erdos Selfridge theorem. It's just a question of how many such subsets are there. For example, if every subset of order n is taken, then the first player should be able to win because he has an advantage. It's clear that he has an advantage. If I take all possible subsets, then he puts his hand on one element, then B puts hand on some element. Those sets that contain that particular element, you don't look at them at all. Then A looks at something, a third element A chooses in such a manner that it's something else, et cetera, et cetera. It keeps doing that. Let me say one thing clearly. So let's see. If the number of subsets then we can draw. That's the statement we're making. So B, for B, there is a way of playing this so that he can draw it. He can come out with at least a draw. If not win, he can at least make sure that A will not be able to win. Because this game can result in a draw. Like tic-tac-toe, most of the times results in a draw. Okay? Games like tic-tac-toe, the first player clearly has an advantage. That's clear because he can choose a square. Generally, a good player will choose the middle square because there are more possibilities there, so on. What it means is, hidden here is a statement like, if the number of subsets is greater than or equal to 2 power n minus 1, then B may not be able to draw. Okay? So I'm putting it the other way around. If the number of subsets is greater than or equal to, so when we make this second statement, I should create a situation where I can show you that, look, A can be so clever that he can win that game. Yeah? So let's do that first. So let's prove the second statement first, and then we'll prove the first statement. Is it clear? So my universal set now sets of the form Z union n minus 1 set such that if one of xi or yi is chosen. Is it clear what? So I choose x1 or y1 or x2 or y2, etc., etc. So in each case, there is a choice. Z is, of course, to be chosen. If all these sets, they do contain Z. Other than Z, what are the remaining n minus 1 elements? So it's a typical subset here will look like. It would look like Z and x1, x2 up to xn minus 1. This is OK. Z and y1, y2 to yn minus 1. Or it could look like Z, x1, x2, y3, y4, etc., etc. How many such subsets can be created? 2 to the power n minus 1. There are as many as 2 to the power n minus 1. Exactly 2 to the power n minus 1 subsets you'll get this way. Any person who can capture all the 2 to the power n minus 1 subsets is the winner. Okay? What has happened is this is a skewed situation. Z is contained in all of them. Therefore, it's very clear that A puts his hand on Z first. A puts a cross on Z right at the beginning. And now, no matter what B does, if B captures x1, A captures y1. If B captures y3, A captures x3. Is it clear? By doing this, it is certain that A will win this game. It's very clear that A will win this game. Every time, so these are paired. If B chooses xi, A chooses yi. And if B chooses yi, A chooses xi. And the way those subsets are constructed, it's clear that A will win the game. Of course, this is a special situation that is created. That is exactly the reason may win. What we are saying is may win. We are not saying that he is going to win in every situation. That's not the statement that is made. He may be able to win in some situations. Whereas, if the number of subsets is strictly less than 2 power n minus 1, there is a manner in which we can come out with a draw. We can get a draw. How is this to be really played? It's to be played by something like this. One, you define what is called danger of a position. What do I mean by set? There is universal set and these are subsets. For example, if A has captured as many as n minus 1 elements from some set, then in the next lot, he'll capture the remaining one. He would want to capture, and then A will win the game. Therefore, that set has a big danger. So this proof of this statement by Erdős actually defines a danger for every set. Okay? For any set in which B has put its hand on, suppose there is a set in which B has put an element. Suppose A does cross and B does circle. Suppose B has put a circle on some element in some set, that set is not in a danger at all. That's very clear because they can never capture all the n minus 1 elements in that set. So the danger of a set is the number of elements captured in that particular set. And it is 2 power the number of elements captured in that set. If captured j elements of A, I And then I add up dangers of all these sets. Okay. Any set on which B has put his hand on is not in danger. That's clear, because that set can never be captured by A. That's clear, because he can never get to all the N elements in that set, because I have already put hand on one element there. So those can even be, it's as good as you reduce the number of subsets you have initially is 2 power N minus 1, but as soon as B captures some element in some set, those sets can go away. They can just be thrown out, okay? It is only those sets where B has not put his hand on. Those matter for B. Those are the danger fellows. They are the danger thing. It's exactly like this in a tic-tac-toe. If I'm putting circles and my opponent is putting crosses, and if the line has size N, if he has put as many as N minus 1 crosses on a single line, that line is a dangerous line for me. That's clear. And how does A win anyway? By creating two such lines. Therefore, I cannot put two circles. Okay. So the larger the number of elements captured in that set, larger is the danger. And that is quantified through this 2 power something. Okay. Then the strategy for B is something like this. The total danger, initially who moves? A moves first. A moves first. He puts his hand on some element. He puts his hand on some element. Therefore, certain number of sets will be captured. So a certain number of sets will come in the danger zone. How much will be the danger for any such set? 2. Because only one element has been put. Therefore, what will be the total danger? It will be 2 multiplied by 2 power n minus 1, which is still less than 2 power n. So the danger is less than 2 power n, the total danger that you have with all these sets added. B plays this game in such a manner that he chooses that element for which the sets that element contains have total largest danger, okay? Then on his, therefore this is played in such a manner that B decreases danger, A cannot increase the danger. The danger to start with will be something that is strictly less than 2 power n. And therefore danger being a monotonically decreasing sequence can only decrease, and therefore A cannot win. Games like this, many situations are unsolved. Answers are not known. Tic-tac-toe is a very fertile ground for a large number of things. You can play a tic-tac-toe game on a m-dimensional space. So you can take n times n times n m times. Okay? How many winning? So it's an n cube in n dimensions. Cube in n dimensions, what are the winning lines? All the straight lines that you can draw, okay? It's a nice exercise that if you have m times, this is the total number of winning lines. How does one see this? It's not difficult. Enclose that cube or a rectangle or a square inside a larger square. So from M, I'm going to M plus 2. So I'm adding one. Length is increased by 2, and the breadth is also increased by 2. Okay? Not N power M plus 2. No, that's not all right. N plus 2 power n. Like a 3 by 3 tic-tac-toe can be put inside a 5 by 5. It can be put inside, put the borders along, that's exact. That gives the number of winning lines. That number gives the number of winning lines. In case n is equal to 3 and m is equal to 2, just check that you have as many as 8 winning lines, which you must have. 3 horizontal, 3 vertical, and 2 diagonals. That's exactly what is given there. Okay? But in general, this is the situation. So I know how many winning sets are there. That is those many. And this is saying if the what is the size of winning set? It is n. And therefore, if this number of winnings, if this is less than 2 power n minus 1, then if this is less than 2 power n minus 1, B will have a way in which he can draw. Okay? B will have his way in which he can draw the game. Okay, so there's considerably a lot to mathematical games. Good to know several things. Involves quite a bit of ingenuity. It's worth reading it. Good mathematics that you can use, put to use, so on and so forth. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sarathane. It was a quite interesting talk and to know about such many nice examples of mathematical games. Our third week of STEMS lecture series will be on 10th of November 2019. The first talk will be given by Professor Rajivail Kalandikar on the talk titled Area of Circles and Its Related Problems. And second talk will be given by Professor K. Narayan Kumar on text compression. Thank you.
Yeah.